God has laid on my heart. It's my life now. It's a mode, a revival mode that I'm in.
Amen.
I'm in the revival mode. And so I asked him, can I speak on revival? But first of all, I want to tell you that I received Christ, and John did too, at the University of Wisconsin in Madison in 1966. Wow. And we were so in love with Jesus when we received him that when he graduated and I graduated, we didn't get into our careers. We decided we want to serve Jesus, telling everybody about Jesus and helping people come to know the Lord, and we joined the staff of Campus Crusade for Christ. And they sent us to the University of Nebraska. We were in Lincoln 1 year, and then they sent us to Omaha for 2 years as directors of the work in Omaha. Then we left staff and we came back to Wisconsin. We lived in Madison, and then these missionaries came through from Peru, South America, and this was amazing. They told about the work, and they told about the need in the Andes Mountains. And after they left, John and I, we looked one another in the eye to eye, and he said, are you thinking what I'm thinking? I said, are you thinking what I'm thinking? We both were led of the Holy Spirit at the same time. Let's go to Peru as missionaries. And we did. Well, I'm not going to go into all the details of Peru, but I'm going to say something, that it was a disaster. It was a chaos. It was horrible. It was so sad what happened in Peru. And when I got back from Peru, I just kept asking God, what happened? What happened in Peru? We went there, we sold everything, we went with 4 kids, we came back with 5. We got a Peruvian son, Isaac, but he chose to be an American. He could choose his citizenship. But when I came back, I was so hungry for God. I was searching for answers. And he said, it has to do with the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Holy Spirit. Amen. I didn't know beans about the Holy Spirit. I really didn't. We were evangelists. We preached and preached and preached. God loves you. It's a wonderful plan for your life. But there's a separation between you and God. What's that? The Holy God and us? Sin. And Jesus died on the cross for our sins. But you can't just know those three things. Oh, I know all that. It's not a matter of knowing it. The fourth and last thing that we share, it's the Campus Crusade for Christ, 4 spiritual laws. We call them in Spanish the 4 certain things. The 4th certain thing is you have to receive Christ into your life. You receive him and you pray. And so anyway, I'm kind of extending this a little bit longer than I thought I would. But anyway, I was reading the scriptures about the Holy Spirit, and I was reading books and books, and God began to work in my heart. And I just said, oh, I want to know if this baptism in the Holy Spirit is for today.
Amen.
If these gifts of healing, yes, and casting out demons are for today.
Yes.
And I want to know if speaking in tongues, woo, is for today. And I was so hungry to know. And God led us to Midwest Christian Center in Janesville. Oh my gosh, that church. Incredibly fantastic. there I received the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And it was, I went forward for prayer and they laid hands on me and nothing happened. And I was so disappointed. I expected to talk in tongues, speak in tongues. And so I stayed there. It was the end of the service. Everybody left. John went back to his seat and I'm standing there. I'm by myself. And Dorothy Benedict, the pastor's wife, walks up to me and says, "What's the matter, Eileen?" I said, "I'm not leaving here until I speak in tongues." She said, "Oh, come, 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 sisters." And so they put me in the middle and they laid hands on me and prayed for me. And in about a few seconds, I started speaking in tongues. This is it! This is it! Oh, I was filled with joy. Oh, I was so happy. I just felt the presence of God. It was incredible. And I said, this is what I needed. This is what I longed for. And it changed my life. From darkness of Peru to the light of the glorious gospel in the power and authority of the Holy Spirit. And so from there, God led us to be missionaries to Mexico. And we went to Mexico. And we started our own church. We pastored for 8.5 years. And then God led John and Eileen to close the church and to start two different ministries. Fantastic. John started a creation science ministry. He graduated in chemistry. He had a scientific mind, as well as a heart so inflamed on fire for Jesus. And so he used all of his creation talks in all over South America, all over Central America, all over Mexico and the United States for evangelism. He would speak on the scientific proofs of creationism, of science, that prove that the Bible is the Word of God. It's the creation. We don't have the gorilla abuelito. No, we don't come from changos. Changos are in Spanish monkeys. And so God used him in that ministry incredibly. I don't know, has anybody ever heard him speak on creation science? Yes. People loved him. He put jokes in it, and he brought all the scientific proofs down to our level so that we could understand what he was saying. And then I was led to go to a GLOW International meeting. A GLOW International is a women's organization in 171 countries of the world. And we didn't have a GLOW in Zacatecas. And the person came, and guess what? Everybody pointed at me. Eileen, you're the president. Me? Are you kidding me? I don't even speak Spanish that well. I don't even know the Mexican culture that well. I'm an American, and you want me to be the president? God confirmed it. Oh, I was in a GLOW for 26 years. Wow. Oh, I loved a GLOW. It's a fantastic ministry. I was an area director in Central Mexico. Then I was vice president of extension. And I traveled all over from coast to coast, border to border, starting new groups of a GLOW all over. Oh, and I just loved it. And I was in leadership training leaders, and I just loved it. Well, then they elected me to be president of a GLOW Mexico. And the director of our whole area, Central America, Panama, Costa Rica, Nicaragua, and Guatemala, and El Salvador, and all that. I traveled all over, and I was so happy. And then God led John and Eileen, finally after 30 years of renting in Zacatecas, to buy a plot of land and to build. We read this book called The Greatest Man of Babylon. It's a book on finances, and it transformed our finances, and we were able to buy this lot, and we started building our house. This lot, God guided us to going up on a mountain and going up on the mountain. Oh, I forgot to tell you, Zacatecas is the second highest city in all of Mexico, 8,200 feet above sea level.
Wow.
It's very high and it's mountainous. And it's only 2% Christians. It's part of the 1040 window of this hemisphere. The ground of Zacatecas, everybody said, is as hard as rock for the gospel. And let me tell you that when John and I and our 8 children preached in the market every Saturday to start our church, we pastored for 8.5 years. When we got this letter, anonymous, it said, if you keep preaching in the market, we're going to kill you.
Oh, no.
Do you think John said, let's go back to the States? No. He said, I am going to keep on preaching. If they kill me, they kill me. But I cannot be quiet. God called us to Zacatecas to preach. And so he kept on preaching, and we were praying for protection. Send your angels charge over us. And sure enough, they threw some rotten tomatoes at us and ucky garbage and stuff. But anyway, and then when we moved into one neighborhood, they, with a slingshot, boom, broke 41 of our windows in our house. The persecution. It was difficult. 41 windows, and they broke into our bus where John had his craftsman's tools for a mechanic. Very expensive, the best tools they stole his craftsman's tools. Then they broke into our van, and they took a knife, and they cut up all the seats into ribbons. Oh, we suffered in Mexico, some things that we suffered in Peru. Peru was, oh my gosh. But we were determined. We said, if we have to die in Mexico, we're going to die in Mexico. We're not going back to the United States. We're not going to run back. He who puts his hand to the plow and looks back is not fit for the kingdom of God, heaven. We put our hand to the plow in Mexico, and no, it doesn't make any difference what they did to us. We loved our enemies. We prayed for our enemies to be saved. And so anyway, where was I? We bought this land, and it comes up like this, and it comes up like this, and then it's flat up here. And this is the best lookout of the whole city. And the whole city is down below. It's gorgeous. There's a picture of it on my display board. And right in front of us is this huge rock formation called the Bulge. And it's the most famous tourist attraction in all of Zacatecas. has a cable car that runs from downtown up there. There's all these tourist shops, there's restaurants, there's museums, there's a Catholic church up there. There's statues of all the war heroes and everything. And the best view of the Bufa is my house on this lookout. We are right in front of it. Other places you see it from an angle, or you see it from the side, or you see it from the back. Lyme is the only place that you see it from right in front. Wow. And so, my house is here. This is open land, flat. Open land, flat. You come up, 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 flat. My house, flat. Go down. Mm-hmm. And so I would then, in front of my house, there's a drop-off of 30 feet down. And down below, it's like up above where we build our house and this land, it's all flat. And so every day, I would walk, while we were building the house, I'd walk around and go down below, up above, walk over here, down below, and one day, I get to this corner before I turn the corner and go up. And I'm declaring, this is God's mountain. This is a holy mountain. Amen. This is a prayer mountain. Yeah. I'm an intercessor. I would pray for the government people, the police, the teachers, the professors, the students, that all the business people, the firemen. I'm praying and that these people would come to know Jesus. Amen. That the Holy Spirit would come down in supernatural signs, wonders, and miracles. And that's, I got over here to this corner and I said, and this is a prayer mountain. And God said, build it. Build it? Build a prayer mountain? The only prayer mountain I know is Pastor Cho, the pastor of the largest church in the whole world in South Korea. He has a prayer mountain. I said, a prayer mountain like big? Like South Korea? And God said, yes. Wow. And I said, but God, my house isn't even built. It took us 7 years. We don't believe in debt. So little by little, over 7 years' time, we built our house. And it was about 3 years into the building of my house. And I said, but God, my house isn't even built. How am I going to build a prayer mountain? Do you know what he said? Oh, he said, don't worry about the money. Wow. I went with my husband. I said, you know what God told me? He told me to build a prayer mountain here, this side of our house. Here, this side of our house, all down below. John, what do you think? Yes, yes. And I went with my 8 kids. They all know and love the Lord. Hey, what do you guys think? Yes, Mom, you go for it. You go for it. Wow. And so then I went with my pastor because we had closed our church. We were supporting another pastor. I said, Pastor, God told me to build a prayer mountain. He said, yes. Yes, Eileen, go. Go for it. So I had all this green light. Everything was go. And we have had, that was 2013. What do we have built today? 2024, 11 years later? No land bought, no buildings built. Over here is a tower 8, my plan, God gave it to me. A tower 8 stories tall that will have a revolving top. And every thousands of tourists are gonna come and they're gonna see the Bufa, that big bulge. They're gonna see the whole city. Behind me are the highest mountains of Zacatecas, and when they get up there, I'm going to say, hey, have you come here today with problems? Do you have health problems? Do you have financial problems? Do you have family problems? Do you have problems with demons? You have come to the right place because God has the answer to your problems. Amen. Come with me down to the 7th floor. Give me a couple minutes. Come with me. And I'm going to go and share the gospel with them. And we're going to have a team of counselors. If they need marriage counseling, if they need financial counseling, if they need a deliverance session, if I'm going to pray for the sick. I've seen so many people get healed. And so I am not discouraged because of all the problems that we had. If I would tell you, I'll just tell you one. This accountant that we had was supposed to report, because we made a nonprofit. Every month he was supposed to report, and he didn't. We paid him every month, and we thought he was reporting, and he didn't. We get a knock on the door. We're from the government, and I invited him in. You owe in pesos 386,000 peso fine. Why? Because you didn't report. But we paid our accountant to report. We didn't get any report. So we went with our accountant. Guess what? He fled to another city. He left. And so we owed this huge amount. Well, we paid it off. God bless you. And so I just wanted to tell you that in the meantime, before we started buying the land, the owner of the land is with us, but she doesn't want to donate the land. She said, no, since my father died, we don't donate any land. But people have come and asked me to sell them the lots on this beautiful view that she owns, all that land down below and everything. And she says, I tell them, no, I can't sell you any land. I'm committed to a project, the Mount of Living Hope. She's with us. So I'm praying every day that God would change her mind and she'd donate. But if she doesn't want to donate, God will provide. Because he told me, what? Don't worry about the money. Right? Right? So, in the meantime, I have this ministry of going to the hospital. I started out on Tuesdays. The people are so needy, so open. They pray to receive Christ, and they get healing for the sick, either themselves or the people. I preach in the open air to all the people out that come out from the hospital, taking a break from inside that horrible atmosphere, and taking a break for some fresh air, and from visiting their sick ones. And I preach, and then we pray for them if they're sick, or the people in the hospital who are sick. I got some testimonies I'm going to tell you later. But besides that, then when John died and went to heaven, I said, God, I'm going to serve you more, more. And so I started going on Thursdays. I go on Tuesdays and Thursdays. And we estimate with my evangelistic team, my hospital team, from my daughter's church, that she and her husband have the largest church in the city of Zacatecas, of about 800 people right now. And so the people in the church have come alongside me to go to the hospital. And we estimate that 800 people a year on Tuesday come to know Jesus. Mm-hmm. And now on Thursday, it's double. About 1,600 people come to know Jesus at the hospital every year.
Nice.
Wow.
Yay. Thank you, Jesus.
Come on.
The glory is all for Jesus. All for Jesus. Without him, I can do nothing.
Right.
But with him, I can do all things Christ who strengthens me.
Amen.
So I have the hospital ministry, and then I have a ministry of the United Prayer online. And people from all over Mexico come, my Glow ladies that I've met from previous years. I was with the Glow for 26 years. And I had a hard time leaving a Glow because when God said, build the Mount of Living Hope, I couldn't do both because Mount of Living Hope is huge. And my presidency as president of Glow was huge, well, a lot of work. And so I said, Lord, what do you want me to do? And he says, leave a Glow. So I left a Glow and I put a younger woman in that I had trained. And she's doing a great job as president of Aglo Mexico. And so then my other ministry besides the United Prayer and the hospital is a School of Success class that I give every week, every Friday. My personal assistant, since John went to heaven, I have his secretary that was his secretary for 3 years. And now she's my personal assistant. She actually, 27-year-old, graduated in law school. She's a dedicated Christian. She's over the photograph ministry in our church. And she sleeps the night with me, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. And she's in my office from 9 to 2 to help me with my ministry. She's a great gal. We're like this. We're so close. We're so close. She's more like a daughter to me now. I only have 2 daughters and 6 sons. Only 8 kids. And 4 are in heaven. 4 and 8? 12. The tribe of Pendleton. Well, so... I love this School of Success class. It's only a 2-minute class in English and in Spanish that goes on Instagram, Facebook, TikTok, WhatsApp. And, yeah, I get 1,000. Well, it varies, but anyway, that's, I'm sorry, it took quite a bit of time to tell you about Eileen. Now, what I want to talk about is revival.
Yay.
Yay. Listen, revival ought to be a normal way of life for all of us. It should be the norm, not something so special, so awesome, so once in a blue moon or once here or once over there. Revival should be your way, your normal way of life and mine. It wasn't. It wasn't. But let me tell you something. Since John died and went to heaven, I needed God so much, so much. When he died, I cried out and I said, God, how can I live without him? How can I live without John? And I really miss him. He was fantastic, fantastic husband. But since he went to be to heaven, I've come into a new level of intimacy with the Holy Spirit that I didn't have before. So it should be a normal way of life. Let me talk about personal revival, because you can have personal revival, or you can have church revival, you can have a city revival, you can have a country revival. I'm going to talk about personal revival. First of all, when you are in a personal revival, you just have more love for God. And you have a deeper commitment Lord, your will be done, not mine, not mine. Eileen, die to self. Not my will, not Eileen's will, not what I want. Lord, only what you want, your will be done. And then we can have more passion for God and personal revival. Oh, I'm so blessed in my daughter's church. They have 260 servants in the different ministries. And my daughter wanted to honor the servants that were doing the best job. And so they all voted, like the most generous servant. They all voted for the most loving servant. They all voted for the most punctual servant. And then they voted for the most passionate servant. And my daughter was giving out presents and honor, a certificate to each of these people. And she called out, and the most passionate is Eileen Pendleton. I started crying. I started crying because I show my love for Jesus and worship. I can't be still. I can't just, I love you, I love you, I love you, I love you, I love you. That's not me. I love you, I love you, I love you, I love you, I love you. That's me. I gotta express the power of God, the authority of God, the worship of God. That's me. And so I guess they thought, well, she's got passion for God. It's just my way of worship and praising Him. And then I went up on stage, I was crying, thank you. All these people voted for me. And then they probably hear me say, Eileen, how are you? It's the best day of my life. Everybody hears me say every time, if I have a bad day, it's the best day of my life. Amen. Yesterday's gone, today, tomorrow's not here, we only have today. Yeah. Let's make the best day of our life today. Yeah. And I have this attitude of every day is my best day. Mm. Oh, I love life. Life is so beautiful, so beautiful. Then, I have more service for God in my personal revival. Like I said, instead of going one day to the hospital, I go 2 days now. More service for God and more time in His presence. You know how I eat my lunch? John used to sit across from me. And now I eat lunch with Jesus. I put on my worship music and I take a bite. Close my eyes, put my fork down, and I love you, I love you, I love you, I love you. I don't sing it, I'm listening to it, but I am showing God my love for Him. And then I swallow, open my eyes, take another bite. I'm in His presence every noon meal, I love eating with Jesus. I'm in His presence. Oh, it is absolutely awesome. And I started, this is something that I never did before in my whole Christian life. I read a book on taking the Lord's Supper every day. I started taking the Lord's Supper every day. Every day, a little piece of it, I say, on the same night which he was betrayed, he took bread and he broke it and ate and gave it to his disciples, saying, this is my body given for you for the remission of sins. This do as often as you drink, often as you eat it, in remembrance of me. And every day I remember his torture, his battered body, his body cut to ribbons, his mutilated body. I have all these adjectives that describe his torture. And I'm in his presence and I'm just saying, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, Jesus. I take the Lord's Supper every day. So anyway, I worship him more. I pray my liked songs list on my phone. And it's on Spotify, so it just goes from one to the next, to the next, to the next, to the next. And I'm one that when I would walk around, I'd trot. But when I'm down there, it's my prayer time. And in my bedroom, I exercise to my praise and worship music. And I stay in shape, but I love my exercise time. I'm in God's presence. I'm in his presence, like, all day long. It's just so awesome. Okay, let's talk about revival in church. Revival in church would be when the supernatural power of God comes for signs, wonders, miracles, healings, all kinds of answered prayer. It's the supernatural power of the Holy Spirit working. Plus, in a revival in church, multitudes of people come, new people are coming into church. And I pray their churches won't have room enough to seat everybody. They're going to be sitting in the aisles. And the church is growing so much that they have to find a new place or they have to extend their walls bigger. That's revival in churches. And so, I want to say also that in a church in revival, they have a discipleship. Yeah. In our church, we have four levels of discipleship. You start out in the basics, and then you go higher and higher and higher. Our church has so many, that's why we have so many servants. Out of 800, 260 are serving God, that have gone through all the discipleship course. And so in these discipleship courses, you come into the power and authority of Jesus in our lives. The power and authority to heal, to cast out demons, as it says in Matthew 10, 7 and 8, the kingdom of heaven has come here. Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, drive out the demons. Freely you have received, freely give. So let me encourage you, if you want a personal revival, start praying for the sick. Start praying to raise the dead. When my husband died, we prayed that God would raise him from the dead. God didn't do it, but we believed that we have that authority. And so I have a whole talk. I'm going to be giving it tomorrow morning at Midwest Christian Center in a women's Bible study. It's called How to Be Happy When Tragedy Strikes. I've learned that. Tragedy struck me when John died and went to heaven. And so many other testimonies. I mean, I told you a few of them tonight. But I have a whole book of them. I wrote a book on the family and the miracles and all the testimonies that I have. So, I want to tell you that I know a marvelous God. Marvelous God. Oh my gosh. He healed me of 17 years of diabetes. When I was in Peru, when I was pregnant with Isaac, he was born there, the diabetes disappeared. My body was fortified during that pregnancy, and I didn't have any symptoms of diabetes. But when he was born, they all came back on me. Mm. Oh, I was so miserable. Just so horrible with diabetes. And one day, God showed me Isaiah 53:5. These words jumped out of the Bible at me. By his stripes, we were healed. We were healed. I said to the Lord, what? When was I healed? And it says, by his stripes. When did he get the stripes? When he was crucified. He paid the price of our sin, and he paid the price of our healing. And I just, whoa! I was healed of diabetes more than 2,000 years ago when Jesus got the stripes. And today, by faith, I receive that healing that he paid for. He already paid for it, and I receive it by faith. And I just began to say, thank you, God. I don't have diabetes. I'm healed. Thank you. Morning, noon, and night. Guess what? No more symptoms of diabetes. Amen. I have been healed of diabetes for over 31 years after suffering 17 years of it. That promise I have used. That promise I used to be healed of cancer, of brain cancer, breast cancer, and cervix cancer. I got the diagnosis. I'm invaded by cancer. Guess what? I am about 13 years healed of cancer.
Amen.
Every analysis, nothing. I had gallstones. I never had an operation.
Wow.
And in one night, I went from the most severest pain that my husband rushed me to the emergency room, and they said, you need a gallbladder operation. You've got stones and gallstones. And guess what? No more pain. Never. The pain went away. They gave me a shot, and it never came back.
Amen.
God has healed me of everything.
Yes.
He's healed me of gastritis. They did an endoscopia. You've got this beginning of an ulcer. That's a whole story why I got this ulcer. It's because of Stephen. He was a terror. My son Stephen, the littlest guy. All my oldest kids, two of them went astray for a while, but I fasted and prayed. I have testimonies, incredible testimonies, to parents to fight with the armor and weapons that God has given us. Prayer and fasting. I prayed and fasted for those ones that went astray, and God brought them back. Stephen lasted 10 years from age 10 to 20. But when he was born, God told me, Stephen had to be born. He is going to be great in the kingdom of God. So I believed God's promise, and I kept saying, God, rescue Stephen. Bring him out of this horrible rebellion. And he did. When he brought Stephen out from one day to the next, when Stephen gave his life to Christ, oh my gosh, he was a new person. He was just so obedient. He loved God with all his heart, soul, mind, and strength.
Amen.
And guess what? A few years later, he was the pastor of the church, El Camino. Stephen is an incredible pastor, preacher. Oh my gosh, he is so strong. So strong. And so, that's, I'm telling you, I know a miraculous God.
Amen.
All my kids know and love the Lord and serve the Lord. That's a miracle.
Amen.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
It's not easy to raise your kids for God these days, but well, I want to tell you that God delivered me from death 3 times. I was a fraction of a second away from death. 3 times I'm passing vehicles on a 2-lane highway and I turn out into the passing, the other lane, and a car comes in my lane. And we're coming at one another at high speeds. If we would have crashed head on, I would have been in heaven. 3 times. And at the fraction of a second, I got in. Oh, all 3 times, I just about had a heart attack. Oh, I just, wow, incredible. God has saved my life so miraculously, because it says in Psalm 91:11, I will give my angels charge
concerning
you. Woo! Yay! Yay. And I wanted to share a testimony with you about at the hospital. This miraculous God, this guy comes up to us and we meet him and he says, I have a tumor in my body. Gigantic, huge, huge tumor. And so we prayed for him. We laid hands on him and we prayed for him. I came back to the hospital the next week and he comes up to me. He said, guess what? My tumor is getting smaller because chunks, huge chunks like this are coming out of my body. Chunks of tumor are breaking off and coming out. I never heard of that in my whole life. What? Oh my gosh. He was so thankful when he came up to us because he knew that we were the ones that prayed for him the week before. And then we prayed again and we said, well, the rest of the tumor, because it wasn't all gone yet. And so we prayed again. The next week we came back and he walks up to us again and he says, hey, you guys, guess what? Now the tumor is coming out in little pieces. He said, I feel like a new man. I am so healthy. I am so strong. I feel great. He's like, glory to God.
Hallelujah.
Oh, thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Then another testimony I want to share with you. This one was so cool. So, I preach and I give the call to salvation. People pray to receive Christ. And then I say, if you want a tract, it's called a story from Chick Tracks. They have pictures.
Mm-hmm.
And we pass out to everybody who wants a Chick Tract, a free Chick Tract. And lo and behold, I wanted to order because my husband and I passed out in the whole city of Zacatecas for 40 years. Chick Tracks. We've covered that whole city with Chick Tracks.
for 40 years. And so we've ordered a lot. And when John went to heaven, then it was my turn to call and order some more Chick Tracks. And I said, how much do I owe you? And they said, you don't owe us anything. Mm-hmm. What? What? I don't owe you anything. Yes, we put you on our missionary list for free Chick Tracks.
Amen.
5,000.
Wow.
Free Chick Tracks. And we just ran out. Gabby and I, when we go to the hospital, we pass out at least 50 a time. Every Tuesday and every Thursday. And so we were getting low, and I called Chick Tracks again. I said, I need 5,000 more. How much? No, nothing. You're on our missionary. Hallelujah, praise God, praise God. So anyway, I pass out this tract, and then I say, who would like to get prayer for sick at the hospital? And people raise their hands. And a lady raised her hands, and she was crying. And she said, my son had an accident, a brain accident. And when I walked into the room, he didn't even know I was his mother. He didn't know me. And so, this isn't mine, because I opened mine.
But I'll open it for you.
I got it.
Okay.
This is mine. So, I prayed urgently for the brain damage in her boy's head. And I prayed so urgently because her heart was just so broken. And so the next week, I'm preaching, and I see a group of people over here, and I walk over and I say to them, does anybody need prayer in your family here? I thought it was one family, for the sick. And the lady responds to me, and she said, you prayed for me last week. I said, I did? I didn't remember her. And I said, remind me, who was the sick person? She said, my son with brain damage. And I went in his room, and he didn't know who I was. I said, oh, I remember you. I remember you. She said, we are all here. We're his family. We're waiting for him to come out and be discharged.
Wow.
He is totally healed.
Amen.
He has all of his mental facilities back. And she said, and here's a cake that we're celebrating this miracle. And we're waiting for him to come out, and we're going to have cake to celebrate.
Come on.
God. And I said, thank you very much, but I'm here to pray for the sick, and so I'm going to go pray for other sick people. And I prayed for them that they would all come to know Jesus, because I said, "This, you can know a miraculous God like I do, and your mom knows that miracle, that miraculous God, because she prayed to receive Christ when that day and when I prayed for her. So these are just a couple of my testimonies. And so I want to tell you that the Holy Spirit is so important in your life. He will help you to pray, and he will help you to worship. He will help you to understand the Bible. When you read the Bible, he will reveal the truth and speak to you. He will reveal the Bible if you ask and say, Lord, teach me. And the Holy Spirit actually gives us health in our bodies, the Bible says. And so let me just share with you that you can have an intimacy with the Holy Spirit, because he is a person. He's not an impersonal force. He's a person, just like the Father, just like the Son, just he's the Holy Spirit. Three persons in one. He's a person, and you can know him. Well, how do we get to know people? By spending time with them. I'm just getting to know Kim. Kim is getting to know me. We're spending time together. Hallelujah. And so spend time with him. Ask him for wisdom. Excuse me. Ask him for guidance. You need wisdom? I don't know what to do here. I don't know where to go. And so, just ask him, and he will reveal to you. He will guide you. Let me share with you that it's so important that you be filled with the Holy Spirit. When we receive Jesus in our lives, all of us receive the Holy Spirit. He dwells in us. But dwelling is different than filled. And the Bible in Ephesians 5:18 says, do not be drunk with wine, but be filled with the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
And so how do you be filled with the Holy Spirit? It says in Lucas, saying Spanish. In Luke 11:13, and it says that if you ask the Father to fill you, he will fill you. Amen. All we have to do is ask. It says, how much more will I give the Holy Spirit, says the Father, to them that ask him.
Yeah.
All we gotta do is ask to be filled, and he will fill you. And so, tonight, we're going to have a little ministry time right now. For those of you that do not speak in tongues, when you ask the Holy Spirit to fill you, like on the day of Pentecost, what did they do? They spoke in tongues. It's the evidence of the Holy Spirit coming and filling you. And so if you haven't ever spoken in tongues, we're going to have, I'll help you to speak in tongues tonight.
Good.
Is there anybody here that needs that? Are you, all of you who are filled with, and all of you speak in tongues? Woo! Well, then the other ministry that I want to pray for you. Oh, there is somebody?
Yeah.
Oh, I'll help you.
Okay, thank you.
Then just stand up, and I am going to pray for revival to be born, for you to seek. To seek the power and authority in the Holy Spirit and the intimacy, the communion, the supernatural in your lives.
Amen.
And for you, it says, and you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be my witnesses. In Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the utter parts of the earth. Do you want power to lead people to Christ?
Yes.
Then receive the power of the Holy Spirit tonight. He's here. He's here. He wants to fill you up. He wants to revive you. He wants to give you that power of the Holy Spirit. And So I would like to pray for you. I'm not going to spend 10 minutes at everybody or 5 minutes. I'm going to lay my hands on you, and that's about it, and pray for the fire of God to fall in your life. Okay, if you want that prayer, stand up.